singing, you know, since I was going to do a short sermon, but now we're doing that shorter song time, I can go for full 40 minutes. Full little Sunday morning message. But no, I'm thankful to be here tonight, and I love the way God works us out after talking about the mourning and repenting and the purification. But now I get to talk about why all this is good. It's all for our benefit. After led into it there, it's all because of the good news of Jesus Christ. And I would invite you to turn to Mark's Gospel, the very beginning of Mark's Gospel, chapter 1. We'll look at verses 1 through 15, which give us the beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah. There, Mark writes, "The beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. Isaiah says, 'I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. He will be a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him.' And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Behold, your day in countryside, and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. They went out confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. For John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message: 'After me comes one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. For I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.' At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven saying, 'You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased.' And at once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. After John was put into prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. He said, 'The time has come. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news.'" This is the word of the Lord. Amen. The time has come. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Brothers and sisters, as we begin this Lent season, as we begin this Easter season, is this not the most wonderful news in all the world? For it's the greatest story that's ever been unfolded. It's the greatest story that's ever taken place. And as we read Mark's Gospel, it's the greatest story that's ever been told. It is truly good news. Because the kingdom of God, God himself, has come near to us. God himself has come near to you. This is the reason that we are here. This is the reason that we can celebrate in all things. It's a source of true joy. It's a source of everlasting contentment. It's the reason that we live. It's the reason that we begin to breathe. It's the reason that we begin this Easter season, this season of Lent. This is the reason that we begin this season of turning from this world and turning and repenting of our sins and turning back to God, either for the first time or again in our lives. We do this because God has first come near to us. And in doing so, he has first brought his kingdom to us. The kingdom of God has come near, to which we say, thanks be to God. This is truly good news, friends. But what I want us to see today, as we begin Lent and as we go through this season of Easter, is not only is this good news, but this is truly, it needs to be life-changing news. And as we begin this Easter series, this series of worship gatherings, special worship gatherings that will come with you, I want to introduce you to the series that we're going to be walking through. It's a series entitled The Characters of the Cross. And in this, we will look through the events of Holy Week, of the Passion Week, through the eyes of the individuals that lived them out, through the eyes of the individuals who witnessed them firsthand and experienced them with their own lives. And we'll do that through the accurate historical account of Mark's Gospel. And I love Mark's Gospel because it gives the good news that it contains. It gives the reason that was written right up front in these first 15 verses that we just read, but especially in verse number 15. Mark's Gospel is centered on the fact that the kingdom of God has come near. And Mark's Gospel is centered on the fact that this reality, that this truth, it demands a response of all those who read it or all those who hear it. And what I want us to see this night is that response is needs to be the right response to this reality. It's the response of repentance. That's what Ash Wednesday, that's what Easter is all about. Repenting, turning from our sins, and turning to the God who has forgiven each and every God has come near to us. That void that once separated us from God, that is our sin, that massive hole that is our sin, that span that once separated us from God, it has been bridged in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is here, and now is the time for us as his followers, for us as his church, to prepare the way for him, to proclaim his message of hope and redemption of sins. And these verses, they give us three realities about what it means to make straight paths for the Lord and what it means for us to repent and believe this good news, both in Easter and in any season of our lives. The first reality of this is witnessed in the first 18 verses. And to begin this process of repentance, to begin this process of turning to the Lord, is we need to first know and then we need to confess that we are all, each and every one of us, sinners who have walked far from straight paths. John the Baptist is the one called by the Lord to get this process of clearing the way for Christ started. And so I ask you, what was John the Baptist's message? What was the message that he brought forth? Verse number 4 tells us that John the Baptist preached a message that was the need for forgiveness of sins for all people. It was the need for all people to confess their sins before the God who had come near to them. It was the need for all people to be baptized. It was for this act of repentance that is baptism, this act of turning away from their sin and turning towards God, this public profession of that, that is baptism, that this was needed for all people, that this need for baptism and repentance of sin was for all people. And I mentioned that it was for all people. Hear me when I say this, this reality, this teaching of John the Baptist, this was a brand new teaching and reality in its day. Because it was not uncommon in this day for Gentiles coming into the Jewish faith, for those entering into the nation of Israel, for those entering into the service of Yahweh's kingdom for the first time. It was not unheard of for those that were once outside of God's kingdom to be baptized. But no Israelite was baptized prior to John the Baptist. I mean, they were a part of God's chosen people just by being born an Israelite. The message of John the Baptist and the message of Jesus Christ, the message that continues into all our day, is that Jew or Gentile, Jew or Samaritan, slave or free, man or woman, in our day, black or white, Republican or Democrat, rich or poor, powerful or powerless, all people need to repent and believe the good news, for we are all in the same place before God. All people need to know and all people need to seek their forgiveness of sins from God and God alone. All people need to know that the only way that for them to receive redemption of their sins is through Jesus Christ. For he is truly the way, he is truly the life, and he is truly the truth. And brothers and sisters, as we sit here today living in this world where anything goes, we need to know and we need to make clear as the church, that he is the only way, that he is the only truth, and that he is the only way for life everlasting. So as we think about that, and as we apply these passages to our lives, I have two questions for us. The first one is simply this: have we responded in repentance to this reality, to this truth? Do we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus Christ has come into this world, that he has come near to us, that he is the very Son of God that has lived a perfect life that we as sinners were never going to be able to live? And that in taking that perfect life through the cross of Calvary, that he has paid the price for each and every one of our sins, no matter how great or how many they may be. Do we know that through his resurrection to new life again, by putting our faith in the fact that he was resurrected to new life again, do we know that we are raised to new life? Do we know that we have received forgiveness? Do we know these things, and has these truths forever changed our lives? Do we know that we know that we know that Jesus Christ has made us new again? And we press Jesus Christ as our Savior into our lives to declare him as Lord. If not, I say, why not today? If not, I say the time has come. Repent and believe the good news. So the second question I have for us is if we have in fact been made new by Jesus Christ, I ask us, are our lives living testimonies that this good news is for all people? Listen, brothers and sisters, this is good news. We have found Jesus Christ. We have found and we are experiencing his forgiveness of sins. We have tasted and we have seen that the Lord, he is good. Friends, this good news is not something that we just keep on the shelf. It's not something that we certainly keep to ourselves, but it's something that we declare, just like John the Baptist, to both all who will come to us and all that we can reach. We declare this truth to all who will listen. We declare this truth in our context to all who will come to the wilderness of the Welsh Mountain and listen to this message. The time has come. The kingdom of God, it has come near. Repent and believe the good news. I ask us, as we enter into another Easter season, is that the message of our lives, and is that the message of our churches? Is that the message that we declare to all, to anyone who will hear? And then in verses 9 through 13, they tell us this, is that though we are in fact all sinners, through Jesus Christ and through Jesus Christ alone, we become children of God. Children of God who God is loves and whom God is pleased with. Because verses 9 through 13 is the account of Jesus' own baptism by John the Baptist. But make no mistake, anytime you come to this moment in Jesus' life, John the Baptist is not the star of the moment. The star of the moment is all three members of the Trinity making their appearance in our world. The kingdom of God coming to us in the most literal sense. So think about this with me. Reflect on the glory, the beauty of this moment, and what is taking place here by the Jordan River. Of course, we have the mesmerizing reality that the Son of God himself is standing in the Jordan River in human flesh, waiting to be baptized by John the Baptist. We then have the Father himself declaring that this is my Son, that this is my Son whom I love. This is my Son whom I am well pleased with. And then it's a final confirmation that Jesus Christ is that Son whom God loves, that Son whom God is well pleased with. The Spirit of God himself descends upon Jesus Christ in this moment. And then verses 12 through 13, from that moment on, Jesus is led in all things, even into temptation, and we know eventually to the cross. He's led by the Spirit of God. And so as I think about these verse, this moment, this baptism of Jesus in view of our lives, do we know that the proclamation of the Father over the Son is now through Jesus Christ, the proclamation that the Father declares over our lives? Do we know that we have both been made new through Jesus Christ, and that through Jesus Christ we become sons and daughters of the living God? Sons and daughters of the living God whom God loves. Sons and daughters of the living God whom God is pleased with. And whom God is pleased with through his perfect Son, Christ Jesus our Lord. And as we go through this life in its highs and maybe most definitely in its lows, do we know that God is not only for us, but that God is actually with us? For there are many trials, there are many temptations, there are many weaknesses that we face as sinners ourselves living in a fallen and a sinful world. But through it all, though we will stumble, do we know that God will not let us fall? Do we know this, and do we believe this? Do we know who we are as we enter into this Easter season? Do we know who we are in Christ Jesus? Because as we have already talked about, verses 14 through 15, they remind us that the time is now. That the kingdom of God is here. That the kingdom of God is now. That the time has come to repent and to believe this good news. As we begin this Easter season, as we begin this series that looks at the characters of Easter, as we begin this series that will look at everyone from Jesus Christ himself to Jesus' betrayer, as we begin this season, do we know beyond a shadow of a doubt who we are in this account? Do we know that what Paul reminds us of in Romans 3, that it is true of each and every one of us, whether in this house or online? Do we know that all of us, each and every one of us, have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God? Do we truly know that all pertains to us as well? Do we know that our sin is just as much responsible as anyone else's for Jesus being hung from that cross? Do we know that there is no way that we can ever earn our place before God? Do we know that without Jesus Christ, one and all are destined for an eternity of responded with repentance? Do we know and have we responded with our lives to the reality that Paul also reminds us of in Romans chapter 3, where he reminds us that all are justified freely by God's grace through the redemption that came about only through his Son, Christ Jesus. For God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement. Through the shedding of Christ's blood, we can be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in God's forbearance, he had previously let sins committed unpunished. But now the time has come that he can no longer do this. For we are justified freely by Jesus Christ. And we are justified only by his grace. And it's only by the free gift of his grace that we are redeemed. Do we know this, and have we turned to this truth in our lives? And are we turning to this truth alone in our lives? Because this is good news. Jesus Christ brings with him good news. God's grace has reached us, and it has reached us as a free gift that comes about only through the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so I say to us, have we turned to this news, to this good news, and are we turning to this good news? Because this is good news, brothers and sisters. God has come into this world, and with him he has brought his kingdom. With him he has brought his perfect kingdom that is free from all the pain, all the suffering, all the agony that you are facing now, all the pain and the suffering that you have faced, and all the pain and the suffering that you will face. God has brought his perfect, sinless kingdom into this world, and he has said to us, come into my grace. Come into my presence. Come into my redemption and my forgiveness of sin. For this is truth. This is the reality of our world and of our lives. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. John puts it well in his gospel. That God so loved the world that he gave to us his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him shall not perish, but they shall have God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe in him stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. Friends, light has come into the world. And that light has a name, you know it. It is Jesus Christ. So I say to us today, as we begin this Easter season, and even as we leave the Easter season in some 40 days, follow the light. Believe in the light. Put your hope, put your trust in the light today. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe this good news. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this season of busyness, we had our board meeting last night, and we have so many things on the agenda, Lord. But as we begin, as we go through it, and as we complete it, Lord, I ask that Peckway Presbyterian, Peckway EC Church, Lord, that each and every one of us that make up this body, Lord, that we would be continually reminded of the beauty, of the awe-inspiring wonder of what God has done for us, of what Easter means for us, of the forgiveness of sins that have been freely gifted to us, Lord. Lord, remind us and just entangle us in the beauty of this reality. Help us as individuals just be drawn closer to you, to be more perfectly molded into your image, Lord, and be more perfect witnesses of your kingdom, Lord. Help us in everything that we say and do, all these services, every one of our Sunday morning worship services, our outreach opportunities, Lord. Help us to proclaim this message of the kingdom of God, Lord, that the kingdom of God has come near to us, Lord. Help us as individuals, as we walk in here, all carrying some sort of a burden. Help us to, and guide us to lay that down at your feet, Lord, to allow you to care. Christ Jesus' strong yet gracious name that we